Praise God. Amen. Today we're going to be talking about the empty tomb. We're celebrating the Easter season. And during March and April, we know that the growth of plants and colorful flowers and trees budding are often associated with Easter. They are indeed welcome signs of spring and the newness that it represents. The real meaning of Easter, however, is the celebration of the resurrection of Jesus Christ. Jesus alone was born to die for the sins of all mankind. He alone, out of his great love for all the people, sacrificed his life on the cross at Calvary, that we could be redeemed from sin, reconciliated to the God who seeks a personal relationship with each of us, and united forever with him. He alone was resurrected from the dead and lives now to intercede for those he had redeemed by his own blood. He alone will return to rule all the nations with wisdom and peace. Praise God. So the empty tomb is a real fact of history. So this afternoon, I just wanted to go over a few of the details. First, Jesus was dead. You would think that that would go without saying, but it doesn't. Many even today believe that during this time Jesus was not really dead. They think that he just went unconscious and then regained consciousness and then came out of the tomb. However, that does not hold water. First, the Romans who crucified Jesus was pros at what they did. They knew death when they saw it. The Gospels say that one man, Joseph of Arimathea, who was a disciple, although he was a secret one, because he was a rich man, a Sanhedrin, that can be found in John 19:38, and he asked for the body so that he could bury it before the Jewish celebration was about to take place. Pilate was amazed that Jesus had died already. After all, he had only been hanging on that cross for about 6 hours. So he sent soldiers to make sure Jesus was dead. The soldiers confirmed it by shoving a spear into his side. He was indeed dead, and he was placed in the tomb, which was closed with a stone that weighed anywhere between 1 and 2 tons. At this point, allow me to mention what happened after the tomb was sealed. The Bible says that when Jesus was placed in the tomb, Pilate ordered the tomb sealed, which meant that the entrance was made tamper-proof, if you will. Anyone caught tampering with the seal was punished by crucifixion upside down. And then a guard was placed outside of the tomb. It was not just one man, not two men, not three, but a Roman guard was generally made up of 12 highly trained soldiers. These men were exceptionally disciplined, and if any were to fall asleep during duty, the entire group was to be executed. With that being said, does it seem likely that Jesus, having been scorched with a cat of nine tails, then nailed to a cross, would regain enough strength after only one day in the tomb, much less 3 days without food and water, to move 1 to 2 ton of stone and not disturb the guard? How could he sneak past them and then walk miles to see his disciples on feet that had been pierced with a nail of the size of a railroad spike? Another theory says that the woman who went to anoint Jesus' body went to the wrong tomb. But Scripture says they were present when Jesus was placed in the tomb. They saw the Roman guard, and they saw them seal the tomb. There was no mistake about this. Yet another theory says that the Jewish leaders took the body to keep the disciples from stealing it. Now think just for a moment. If that were true, then when the disciples began preaching the resurrection, all the Jewish leaders had to do was produce this body to prove them wrong, and then Christianity would have been dead as a doornail. Some think that maybe the disciples saw a hallucination. That's what Thomas thought. But the Scripture tells us that Jesus appeared to some of them and ate breakfast with them. Last I heard, hallucinations and thereof, do not eat food. And in this instance, as in others, he appeared to more than one person. Thomas placed his hands in Jesus' nail-scarred hands, and there he was convinced. And I want to share one more theory. This one is the one that says that the disciples themselves stole the body. That one holds no water either. Just the other day, the disciples feared their very lives when Jesus was arrested. So what would make someone think that all of a sudden they would become brave enough to pull something like this? Remember what I said about the Roman guard? Can you imagine a bunch of fishermen sneaking past the guard, moving the stone ever so quietly, and then trying to take the body? Then there's the fact that they fiercely proclaimed the resurrection, being threatened with death for doing so. No one willingly dies for what they know to be a lie, do they? Yet every one of the disciples, except John, was killed because of their faith in the risen Christ. In 1 Corinthians chapter 15, 3-8, these verses give us some evidence. Can you imagine in a courtroom scene when the attorney calls over 500 witnesses to stand, and they all said, "I saw him alive after he was dead and was buried." And this scripture says that over 500 people saw Jesus after he rose from the grave. In fact, Simon Greenleaf, one of the men responsible for making the Harvard Law School the famous institution that it is, says that the resurrection is one of the best supported events in history, according to the laws of legal evidence administered in the courts of justice. Frank Morrison, another attorney, set out to write a book refuting the resurrection, but he ended up writing one of the best defenses of the resurrection, entitled, "Who Moved the Stone?" And there had been others. The resurrection cannot, my friends, be disproved. The evidence is not only plentiful, but it is overwhelming. He rose from the grave. Make no mistake about it. It is a historical fact. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. He is risen. He is alive.